Tantor Audio presents The Man He Became, How FDR Defied Polio to Win the Presidency, by James Tobin. Narrated by Charles Constant. One of the central problems facing anyone dealing with Franklin Roosevelt's personal history was just what made him the man he became. Joseph Alsop. Prologue, March 4, 1933. The Capitol. Franklin D. Roosevelt sat in a plain chair waiting to be summoned to the chamber of the United States Senate. It was 11:30 in the morning on the day of his inauguration as President of the United States. At noon, he was to watch his running mate, John Nance Garner of Texas, take the oath as Vice President. Then he would walk outside for his own swearing-in at 1 o'clock. He was waiting in the room reserved for the Senate's Committee on Military Affairs. Several assistants sat with him. Among them, his eldest son, James, always called Jimmy, 26 years old, brawny and an inch or two taller than his father. At 10 minutes to noon, someone looked in and said they were ready for him in the Senate. Roosevelt hitched himself to the edge of the chair, placed his hands on his thighs, and pushed until his legs were straight out in front of him. He felt through the fabric of his trousers for metal locks on the custom-made braces that encased his legs. Then he snapped the lock shut so his knees would not buckle when he rose. Jimmy stood and faced him. Father and son grasped each other by the arms and, with a quick heave, the elder Roosevelt rocked up onto his feet and straightened at the waist. With one hand he grasped a wooden cane. With the other he held Jimmy's arm. Under his trousers, the bars and cuffs and belts of his braces held his legs rigid from his heels to his buttocks. His cane, his son, and his own stiffly braced lower body formed the three legs of a reasonably stable tripod. Slowly they moved across the room and into the corridor. There Colonel Edward Halsey, Secretary of the Senate, met them and held up his hand. Halsey said he was very sorry, but the Senate wasn't quite ready after all. Jimmy and his father stopped, pivoted, and ambulated back into the Military Affairs Committee room. At the chair, Roosevelt pivoted again, set down his cane, gripped his son, and lowered himself onto the seat, legs locked straight in front. He reached behind his knees, undid the locks, pulled his knees up, hitched himself backward, and rested his hands on the arms of the chair, ready to tighten his grip if he began to tilt and fall to the floor. After 10 more minutes, the Senate was ready. Jimmy stood. Roosevelt pushed his legs down and locked the braces. Father and son heaved, and he was standing. They moved across the room and into the corridor, where members of the Committee on Arrangements waited to escort him. A voice ahead of him was announcing, "The President-elect of the United States." Then he was inside the brilliantly lit chamber. Senators, congressmen, the justices of the Supreme Court, the military chiefs, members of the diplomatic corps, his children, his mother, his wife in a purple-blue gown, holding an enormous bouquet of violets. All were looking at him. Jimmy escorted him to a new chair, and there, between President Herbert Hoover, whom Roosevelt had defeated in the November election, and Senator Joseph Taylor Robinson of Arkansas, leader of the new Democratic majority, Roosevelt sat again, unlocked the braces, pulled up his knees, and lightly grasped the arms of his chair. He listened as 15 new senators and the new vice president were sworn in, and the Senate of the 72nd Congress was declared adjourned. Then the Senate chaplain, the Reverend Zabarney Thorne Phillips, rector of Washington's Episcopal Church of the Epiphany, asked the assembly to rise for prayer. Every one of the hundreds of people in the Senate chamber stood up, except the president-elect. A reporter in the press gallery saw Roosevelt lean forward for an instant, as if by instinct, then he settled back. Senator Robinson, now standing, glanced down at Roosevelt. Robinson was hardly known for courtliness. He had once been suspended from the Chevy Chase Country Club for punching a fellow golfer on the 15th green. But at this moment he did something, another watching reporter put it, that should win him a golden mark in the Manual of Gentlemen. He dropped to his seat beside the president-elect. Everyone else in the room remained standing for the prayer. The moment came to move outside for the presidential oath of office and the inaugural address. the Capitol's corridors filled with people, the crowd jammed up at the great door that opened onto the Capitol's East Plaza. Roosevelt stood behind Herbert Hoover and waited, his bulky upper body pressed down on the joints of his knees. Holding himself upright was a concerted act of strength and balance. Then Jimmy and he, now in top hats, were out the door into cold, gray daylight under lowering clouds, moving slowly down a long ramp that led to the speaker's platform and the lectern itself. Members of the Hoover administration, Roosevelt's own new cabinet secretaries, and members of Congress walked in a close-packed formation. 100,000 people were watching. 12,000 were seated. The rest stood in a crowd that spread across the plaza and East Capitol Drive, and up the front steps of the Supreme Court and the Library of Congress, and into the branches of the surrounding trees. 100 press photographers straight in front of him clicked their shutters. Newsreel cameras whirred. Roosevelt moved toward them all with a slow, swaying gait, Jimmy next to him, swaying in rhythm with his father. The procession blocked the crowd's view of anything but Roosevelt's shoulders and head. But if Jimmy and he had been walking alone, people would have noticed that with each step he leaned a bit to one side, while on the opposite side he hitched his shoulder just enough to swing the leg on that side forward. The coordinated movements of the shoulders and the leg were smooth and almost simultaneous. Anyone who saw his gait could see he was crippled, but with help he was walking. He reached the lectern, grasped it with one hand, set down his cane, and removed his top hat. Jimmy moved back a few steps. Roosevelt swiveled to face Chief Justice Charles Evans Hughes. With his left hand, he gripped the lectern. As Hughes read the words of the oath, beginning, "Do you, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, solemnly swear?" Roosevelt held up his right hand. When Hughes completed the question, Roosevelt lowered his right hand to the Dutch Bible that had been in his family since the 17th century. Breaking precedent, he did not, after Justice Hughes posed the question of the oath, simply say, "I do." Instead, he recited the entire oath, holding the lectern with his left hand, resting his right hand on the first page of Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. For most of his life, he had hoped to become president. For 12 years he had prepared for the task he had just performed, walking to this lectern before an enormous audience and standing upright to take the oath of office. The performance had been the culminating and indispensable act of the great struggle of his life. It was not an act of deception. He was not trying to fool anyone into thinking he was not crippled. Anyone who read the newspapers knew that. Rather, it was a deliberate show of strength, a silent, symbolic assertion that he could bear the burden of the presidency. The preceding week had been the worst in the history of the American economy. People felt a collective desperation unknown in the United States since the Civil War. The banking system was collapsing. Indeed, when many in the Capitol crowd tried to draw cash from their hotels later that day, clerks refused. The banks at home had closed during the inaugural festivities. 1 in 4 Americans was out of work, and the prospect of many more losing their livelihoods loomed over everyone. 2 million people or more were riding freight trains in search of a chance to work. Dairy farmers in Iowa, Nebraska, and Wisconsin had blockaded roads and dumped thousands of gallons of milk on the pavement in an effort to drive up starvation prices of 2 cents a quart. On the left, there was dead serious talk of the need for social revolution. On the right, of the need for a dictator. Most people in the Capitol crowd could hardly see Roosevelt. Even those close to the rostrum could see only his shoulders and hatless head darting left and right for emphasis. Loudspeakers broadcast the rich tenor of the upper crust inflections over the crowd. Not all the way to the edges where people could not hear, but microphones relayed the voice over the radio to the whole country. He had told his assistants beforehand that he saw little point in using the speech to announce any specific policy. The main thing was to give people reason not to be afraid. So he came to his main purpose promptly. "This nation will endure as it has endured," he said, "will revive and will prosper. So let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror. which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. Our common difficulties, thank God, concern only material things.
By many accounts, Roosevelt's speech exerted a powerful effect on many in the crowd and millions listening to the radio. A man in Cleveland named Raymond Hummel was one of many who wrote to Roosevelt to express his gratitude.
Today, sitting among a gathering of the all-but-forgotten men during your inaugural address, Hummel wrote, I've seen those worried looks replaced by smiles and confidence. Eyes fill up with tears of gratitude. Shoulders lifted and chest out. In New Jersey, Albert Rutherford wrote, Never since the news of the armistice reached this country have I had such a vibrant and electric feeling come over me as when you made your vibrant inaugural address. In Florida, Dorothy Fullinger said, I felt as if I could stretch out my arms and cry, I'm glad I'm an American. It gave me a new thrill in life, something to live for. Praise in the press was all but euphoric. The next day's Cleveland Plain Dealer voiced the typical view. Millions will say as they read the inaugural address this morning, here is the man we've been looking for. Roosevelt's remark about fear got less play in the papers than his promise of action now and his plea for power, as great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe. But in the coming weeks and months, as he kept his promise of extraordinary action and people began to think the country might indeed recover from the catastrophe, they remembered the sentence from the inaugural speech, the idea that fear alone could paralyze, and that if one went ahead in spite of fear, the paralysis might recede. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself, became the epigram of the moment. Americans knew that Franklin Roosevelt's legs had been paralyzed by the disease that most of them called infantile paralysis. But only his intimates knew enough to appreciate the parallel between his injunction to the nation, indeed his entire response to the Great Depression, and his own experience of paralysis, fear, and recovery. Nor have many since fully appreciated that Roosevelt's momentous presidency sprang from a personal drama that began with a virus, then grew and grew until it took the national stage and shaped history. Roosevelt's gifts and flaws were myriad and mingled. He has always resisted efforts to see him whole. A distant cousin by marriage, the powerful columnist Joseph Alsop once wrote that one of the central problems facing anyone dealing with Franklin Roosevelt's personal history is just what made him the man he became. No one has solved that problem, probably no one will. As one of his earliest and greatest biographers, the playwright Robert Sherwood, who worked for FDR and knew him well, wrote, I tried continually to study him, to try to look beyond his charming and amusing and warmly affectionate surface into his heavily forested interior. But I could never really understand what was going on in there.
So there is no simple solution to Alsop's problem. Poliomyelitis by itself did not make Roosevelt the man he became. The determinants of anyone's life are legion. No single factor explains all.
But one cannot see Roosevelt in full without a deep understanding of his encounter with disease and disability. The crippling of his lower body and his complicated response to that crippling altered the course of his career, shaped his view of life, and changed his relationships with others, from his intimates to the entire American public. Without the polio virus, and what it did to FDR, the history of American life since the 1920s would not be what it has been. It is a truism to say that Roosevelt overcame polio to become president. It is just as accurate to say that Roosevelt would not have been the president he became, probably would not have been president at all, had it not been for the germ that infected him in 1921. It seems to me that when I was growing up in the 1960s, everyone knew Franklin Roosevelt had been crippled. When I was no older than 6 or 7, my grandmother told me a tale of a heroic, crippled president who once had struggled bravely across a stage to give a speech. But either I am wrong about what was once common knowledge, or what was once common knowledge has become awfully muddled in the meantime. I believe it's the latter. But exactly how this happened is a puzzle to me. When I began research, I found that Roosevelt's major biographers, with the exception of Jeffrey C. Ward, had dealt with his paralysis as only an isolated episode. They described it in brief, then left it behind for the larger matters of politics, the New Deal, and World War II. Whether they believed the impact of polio on FDR to be great or small, they didn't say very much about it. That I understood. To tell an entire life story as large as Roosevelt's, even in several volumes, a biographer has to stick to business or find, as several who tried it have found, that his own life may not be long enough to finish the job. Nonetheless, the big books did not answer my questions about FDR's condition. I came to expect, when someone learned what I was doing, to hear something like this: "He hit it, right?" Or, "Isn't it amazing that it was all covered up?" I read Hugh Gregory Gallagher's book FDR's Splendid Deception, and suspected that Gallagher's main idea, that Roosevelt and the people around him engaged in a campaign of deceit about his condition, rather outran the hard evidence. Then I went back and sampled the arguments that raged in the 1990s over designs for the Franklin D. Roosevelt Memorial in Washington, D.C., and there I found Gallagher's idea about a splendid deception all over the place. Important and popular writers said things such as, "It's hard to imagine in this era of journalistic strip searches that only 60 years ago a president was able to hide such a huge fact of his daily life from the American public," Maureen Dowd. And, "He relentlessly, obsessively hid his condition from the American people," Charles Krauthammer. The evidence shows these assertions to be terribly misleading at best. Yet, since that debate in the 1990s, such references to Roosevelt and polio have become commonplace. Whenever I spoke with someone who remembered the 1930s and 1940s, I would ask if he or she knew at the time that FDR was crippled. Everybody said they knew. But some people said this: "We didn't know how crippled he was." In contemporary source materials, I found the same remarks made by people who had seen Roosevelt in person when he was president. Many were surprised, even shocked, by the extent of his disability. This was especially true of people who happened to see assistants carry him up or down stairs. Others said, "We knew he was crippled, but people didn't talk about it." Or, "We knew, but we forgot about it." Or, "We knew, but we didn't think of him that way." People knew, but didn't know. Knew, but didn't think about it. Year after year, in the 1930s and 1940s, there was a massive national drive on Roosevelt's birthday to raise money to fight infantile paralysis, with Roosevelt's picture on posters and appeals over his signature. But people didn't think about the president being crippled. These were signs that I had a complicated story to tell. More complicated, certainly, than earlier writers had shown it to be. The story would have to take account of a culture in which, as Maureen Dowd put it, the journalistic strip search was indeed not routine, in which much more was kept private and privacy was more respected than it is in our own time. It was not only a matter of what people did not know. It was also a matter of what people did not think they ought to know. In time, I came to focus on the period between the onset of Roosevelt's illness in 1921 and his first election to the presidency in 1932. Those were the years when an absurd wager of which no bookmaker would have given odds turned out to be a winning bet with a spectacular payoff. After 1932, his accommodation with disability was a fait accompli. That act in the drama of his life was done. Franklin Roosevelt said little and wrote less about what he really thought and felt. That was his strategy as a politician and his nature as a person. Not for him the meaty, introspective letters of biographical subjects who wear their hearts on their sleeves. The New Yorker writer Richard Rovere once remarked that, as a writer of letters, FDR was a credit to Western Union and the Bell system. He regarded letter writing as a nasty chore, to be got out of the way as quickly and painlessly as possible. He did not keep a diary or write a memoir. One can learn a lot about what he did about his disability, including what he said about it to other people, which was itself a form of action. But no one will ever learn exactly how he felt about it. So this is a story pieced together largely from what Roosevelt and the people around him did and said. The mysteries of his heavily forested interior remain. But the silences guarding his condition are part of the story too. This leads me to say a word about the lexicon of disability. After a good deal of thought, I chose to use the words crippled and cripple in telling this story. In our own era, of course, those words, though still used, are widely regarded as offensive. In Roosevelt's time, it was not so.
People of the 1920s and 1930s attached those words to people without understanding that they were applying a social stigma, a scarlet C, that was often far more disabling than the physical condition itself. To understand Roosevelt's situation, in his time, not ours, one needs to enter a realm in which the stigma of physical disability was like the presence of oxygen in the air, utterly taken for granted, and therefore terribly powerful. I felt I could not lead the reader into that realm without using the words for his condition that he and everyone else used. Disability was in use then, too, but crippled was more common and more telling. To substitute words we now deem appropriate, such as handicapped, physically challenged, and the like, would be, I think, to paper over an essential element of Roosevelt's problem. Part 1. Virus and Host. Summer, 1921. Chapter 1. Infection. July 28, 1921. The virus that causes poliomyelitis entered Franklin Roosevelt's body in the summer of 1921. At the moment of infection, he was a famous and vigorous young man on the rise toward national leadership. The virus was small beyond imagining. 10 more years would go by before the first electron microscopes revealed that the poliovirus resembles a distant planet inscribed with tiny canyons. The virus is not alive in the way a bird is alive, or even in the way a bacterium is alive. It is nothing more than a little sphere of fat enclosing a smaller strip of genetic material. It cannot move by itself. It does not eat or breathe. It is at most half alive, a parasite. To reproduce, it must enter a human body, then survive an onslaught from the protective machinery of the body's immune system, then blunder up against a welcoming cell in the human intestine. If the virus can burrow inside that cell, its fatty capsule dissolves, exposing the strip of genetic chemicals within. Then a bizarre meshing of genetic equipment ensues. Like the two sides of a zipper, the strip from the virus unites with a matching strip from the intestinal cell, forming an assembly line that begins to duplicate the original virus by the thousand. Overloaded, the cell bursts, and the virus's progeny collide with neighboring intestinal cells, and the multiplication spreads. Even then, the effect of this sub-microcosmic production would likely be negligible. Most of the virus's human hosts suffer nothing worse than a headache and a mild fever. The immune system overwhelms the virus and flushes it out of the body, and the human host goes on with life none the wiser. But in a fraction of those infected, fewer than 1%, the virus escapes from the intestinal tract into the central nervous system. It has an affinity for certain cells in the spinal cord that govern the movement of muscles. If the virus finds these cells, it destroys them. Sometimes only a few, sometimes a great many. The number of spinal cord cells destroyed determines the fate of the human host. If only a few cells are destroyed, the host might be only temporarily hobbled, then recover completely. If a great many cells are destroyed, depending on their number and location, he might be left badly damaged or dead. Outside the human host, the virus can escape disintegration for as long as 6 months. To propagate, its only purpose, if it can be said to have a purpose, it must find its way into a susceptible human being. Its best chance of doing so comes in the heat of summer. The whole Northeast had been roasting for days. In Rochester, New York, police were attributing a double murder and suicide to heat craze. In New York City, the chief clerk of the Edison Electric Company collapsed of heat prostration and died. Inside Manhattan's traffic court, the magistrate allowed boys to roam through the courtrooms to sell lemonade. On 10th Street in Greenwich Village, members of Fire Engine Company 18 filled their portable water tank and waved the kids in, dozens of sweaty boys in woolen pants, jostling and dunking each other, spitting and swallowing the cloudy water. So it was a good day to get out on the Hudson River, where at least there might be a breeze. And Franklin Roosevelt would seize any chance to get afloat. He loved the water. On his mother's side, he was the scion of an old seafaring family. He had grown up sailing small boats on the mid-Hudson and among rocky islands of the northern seacoast.
As a teenager, his great ambition had been to attend the U.S. Naval Academy and command ships at sea. But his parents had said no, that his future lay among men like the ones he was joining for today's outing on the river. Well-dressed, well-educated, well-heeled men of business, law, and government. All were friends of the Greater New York Council of the Boy Scouts of America, of which Roosevelt had just been elected chairman. He found them gathering just after lunch in the clubhouse of the Columbia Yacht Club, a pleasant, low building with broad porches and big windows on Riverside Drive at the foot of West 86th Street. They mingled in paneled rooms hung with lovely old naval prints like the ones in Roosevelt's own collection, one of the finest of its kind in the country. Soon the men moved to the pier outside, then boarded small boats to be ferried to the steam yacht Pocantico, pride of Baron G. Collier, the largest landowner in Florida and one of the richest men in New York. Just after 2 o'clock, the yacht slid away from the city's edge and began to glide north up the river. It was bound for Bear Mountain State Park, 40 miles north, where the men would join hundreds of Boy Scouts for a tour of inspection and a big dinner. Scouting was all the rage, with a heavy concentration of members in New York and its suburbs. Among these boys, the summer outing to Bear Mountain was the focus of the entire year. Throughout the fall and winter, scouts attended weekly meetings to learn skills to apply on the annual campout: firemaking, forestry, astronomy, mapping, compass reading, signaling, outdoor cooking. The whole point of the scouting year was to prepare for this trip. The boys earned the right to go. Roosevelt heartily approved of the scouts. His oldest son was a scout already, and he wanted his three younger boys to join when they could. He believed city boys should hike forest trails and learn to build a fire without matches. He himself had grown up tramping the woods and wetlands of his family's home up the Hudson, shooting and stuffing birds. That, to his mind, was a proper boyhood. A city-bred Boy Scout may be a product of the streets and of artificial conditions of living, he wrote, yet he discovers that the woods, the birds, the fields, the streams, the insects speak a language he understands. But he was taking today's trip to Bear Mountain not just for the sake of the scouts, nor just to escape the sweltering city. It was the sort of event he attended these days as often as he could for political purposes. From 1913 to 1920, exhausting years of rearming, war, and demobilization, he had been Assistant Secretary to the U.S. Navy under President Woodrow Wilson. Then, just a year before, in July 1920, the Democratic Party had nominated him to run for Vice President. At 38, he had been 2 years younger than Theodore Roosevelt, his uncle by marriage and distant cousin by blood, when the latter had been nominated for Vice President in 1900. Roosevelt and his presidential running mate, Governor James M. Cox of Ohio, had been badly beaten by Warren G. Harding and Calvin Coolidge. But Roosevelt had sealed his status as a rising star, and now he was cultivating the associations he would need for a statewide race in New York. He might run as early as the following year, in 1922, when he would be just 40 years old. He might make a bid for the U.S. Senate seat occupied by William Calder, the Republican real estate developer who had built much of Brooklyn but made no discernible mark in Washington. Or he might challenge Nathan Miller, the Republican governor who had barely nudged the popular Al Smith out of Albany in the Harding-Coolidge landslide of 1920. Al Smith was Roosevelt's ally and friend, of a sort. If he decided to run for governor again, Roosevelt would defer to him. If not, Roosevelt would make a highly plausible Democratic candidate for governor of the Empire State, and thereby become, quite automatically, a potential candidate for president. There was no need to decide any of that now, in the summer of 1921. For the moment, after 8 years entrenched in Washington, Roosevelt was simply reestablishing himself as a New Yorker, thus the chairmanship of the local Boy Scout Council and a list of other good works for worthy local organizations. Each endeavor meant more opportunities to make new friends and bolster old ones. On this day trip to Bear Mountain, for instance, every handshake, every quiet chat, every photograph for the newspapers might do a little good toward the greater goal. He was only 39 years old. He possessed one of the great names in American politics. He planned to do a great deal. Aboard Pocantico, he was a tall figure telling stories and shouting with laughter,
I love it.
As a student at the exclusive Groton School and Harvard, he had not excelled in sports, but he certainly looked like an athlete. He stood an inch or so above 6 feet, but somehow seemed larger, perhaps because of his especially large head and jutting chin, and his habit of quick and incessant movement. In Washington, he had hurled himself into weekend matches in golf, tennis, baseball, and field hockey. During the World War, he had plunged into exercises and cross-country runs organized for government men by the great Yale football coach Walter Camp, who called Roosevelt a beautifully built man with the leg muscles of an athlete. At his family's summer home on the island of Campobello, New Brunswick, he loved to lead his 5 children through a risky chase game called Hare and Hounds, which involved racing up and down rocky escarpments. Instead of walking, he often jogged or ran. An associate during the war remembered him flying down the steps of the Naval Observatory, 2, 3, or 4 at a time, bobbing up and down like a man jumping rope. At his home in upstate New York, he chopped trees, sailed ice boats, sledded with his children, and charged back up the slopes at full tilt. Yet, for all his vigor, something made him not quite the quintessential man's man. In his 20s, he had been rather staggeringly handsome. At the time of his engagement in 1904, his 19-year-old fiancée had blurted to a friend, "I can never hold him. He's too attractive." But he had been handsome in a slightly prissy way. A reporter who compared his looks to those of his world-famous cousin, then the President of the United States, said that while nature had left Theodore Roosevelt's blocky head unfinished, it had lavished perhaps a little too much loving attention on Franklin Roosevelt's face. One of Theodore Roosevelt's nieces, Corinne Roosevelt Robinson, later likened Franklin's youthful looks to the beau ideal of the Victorian commercial artist. "There used to be satin handkerchief boxes," she remarked once, "and on top of them there were painted figures with a gentleman dancing a minuet with a handkerchief in his hand. In our family, we called a certain type handkerchief boxy, and that was Franklin in his early 20s. Franklin wasn't effeminate," she said, "but he wasn't rugged." Theodore Roosevelt's daughters liked to point out that their sturdy brothers, as young men, had rowed, while Franklin had sailed. They thought that was a revealing difference. They had always said, with titters, that their distant cousin's initials might have stood for Feather Duster. And if Corinne Roosevelt Robinson insisted FDR was not effeminate, her acid-tongued aunt, Alice Roosevelt Longworth, had referred to him as Miss Nancy, slang in society circles for homosexual. That was pure calumny. Roosevelt's preference for women was obvious throughout his life, yet others too saw some thread in his fabric that struck them as vaguely feminine. The journalist, Marcus Childs, would later say he had a kind of feminine intuition, the quality of the actor, who could be photographed and who could speak always with just the right camera angle. An associate of later years remarked that he was the most androgynous man I ever knew. No man acted more hale and hearty, but he used language that a conventional man's man might hesitate to use. When he was ill, for instance, he might say he felt weak as a kitten. He seemed a little more at ease with women than he did with men. His father had been 25 years older than his mother, who had the more powerful personality of the two parents. Indeed, Roosevelt had been dogged since youth, even among relatives and good friends, by the assumption that he was a mama's boy. In fact, though his mother tried to make his decisions and determine his course, he had been defying her and setting his own course since his teenage years. By now, nearing the age of 40, the slim dandy of the handkerchief box had grown thicker and ruddier. He no longer took care to dress snappily, but, as a woman friend said, you couldn't make him unattractive, whatever you did. His smile and his habits of speech made the deepest impressions. His smile was massive and winning, with none of the lock-jawed frigidity of upper-crust stereotype. It was an expression that quivered with animation, shifting from delightful to surprise to warmth in the space of seconds. His tenor voice and superb enunciation identified him instantly as a man of American society's highest echelon, though in his refined accent some also heard a hint of the remote coastal villages of Maine where, as a privileged boy fascinated by the sea, He had made friends among fishing boat captains. When introduced, he seemed merely to fit all the categories of the good fellow, as a writer would put it later. He was a backslapper, a mixer, and all the rest of it. The kind of undergraduate who would, and did, make a fine permanent chairman of his class committee. But his charm far exceeded ordinary good fellowship. He seemed perfectly delighted to be who he was and equally delighted to bring everyone else in on the sheer fun of being Franklin D. Roosevelt. You knew immediately you were dealing not with an ordinary person, but with a personage, a presence larger than others and more alive, as if surrounded by a sparkling aura. He regarded himself as someone who ought to be recognized and reckoned with. Even as a young boy, he had signed letters to his parents with his initials, FDR. In his early adulthood, that quality had struck many people as sheer arrogance. As a rookie state senator, barely out of his 20s, he affected an air of such upright gentility that he reminded veteran Poles of a snooty young Episcopalian clergyman. If they asked him to compromise, he would toss up his chin and say, "No, no, I won't hear of it." But 10 years in politics had sanded off the haughty shell. The personality he displayed now was all but irresistible. The word charm invariably came up in conversations about him. But it was a strange admixture of forces. There was supreme self-confidence, as if no one could possibly doubt his sincerity, goodwill, and ability. Yet there was also an extraordinary determination to please, as if he were driven by an inner demon that would not quit until he was liked and admired. One who did admire him referred to the amiably insistent force of his personality. After a while in his presence, some got tired of it. He seemed supernaturally capable of tuning to the frequency of other people. His wife later said he was always particularly susceptible to people, so he took color from whomever he was with, giving to each one something different of himself. Among bookish people, he would display his knowledge of American history, while among natural scientists, he could recount experiences in ornithology and forestry. "He was fantastically sensitive to people around him," said a woman friend who had known him for many years. "Almost like a compass needle, he would turn to people. Like a chameleon, he changed colors with the person he was talking with. Anyone meeting him would encounter a big, friendly smile," an observer reported, "and the glint of intense interest in his sparkling eyes. He would encourage his new friend with little laughs and goads and urgings such as, 'Really? Tell me more.' Well, what do you know? Same things happened to me dozens of times." "Oh, that's fascinating." If you liked him, this treatment indicated a genuine and winning sensitivity to your ideas and desires. If you weren't so sure about him, the effect was more like that of a well-performed show, a deliberate exhibition of traits calculated to gain favor. He had developed these skills as a child, an only child, with adults, especially women, but not so much with peers. As a young boy, he had taken his schooling from tutors in his home. Then, when he was 13, the age at which other boys of his social class were leaving home for prep school, his mother held him close for another year. So he started at Groton School outside Boston when his classmates already had endured their first-year trials together, and after this late start, he never caught on with the popular crowd. At Harvard, he remained outside the in groups. His deepest ambition in college was to be chosen for Porcellian, the most exclusive of the social clubs, but he was anonymously blackballed, a slight that a relative thought was the bitterest moment of Franklin Roosevelt's life. And one of the complaints about him at Harvard was simply that he tried too hard to be liked. He was still doing so, though he was better at it. Never quite one of the boys in his youth, he seized every chance to be one of the boys now. This afternoon, for instance, aboard the yacht Pocantico, he was plunging headlong into fraternal revelry. With Prohibition dominating the headlines, the men aboard were staging a well-lubricated mock trial of Richard Enright, New York's commissioner of police, who had been comically caught transporting a suspicious-looking walking stick that turned out to contain a prohibited amber liquid. FDR took the role of the outraged prosecutor, roaring with mock alarm, playing the part to the hilt. The men, laughing along with this burlesque, came from two spheres of power. The first was Roosevelt's native sphere. These were men of Wall Street and Park Avenue, born to wealth and influence, such as William M. Chadbourne, Harvard '00, one of Manhattan's leading corporate lawyers. The other sort included self-made scramblers like Police Commissioner Enright, the first New York cop to work his way all the way to the department's top post, thanks to the friendship of Mayor John Francis Red Mike Hylan, a brawler in the wars of Tammany Hall, the city's democratic machine. Roosevelt had embarked on his political career as a young man wholly of the first sphere. Now, in 1921, he had one foot planted in the second sphere of power. He had made many friends among politicians and promoters of lesser social rank, but greater political wisdom. To his long head start in life, he had added their techniques and tools. He knew now how to hustle and maneuver, how to plan and plot without divulging his intentions, how to give and withhold. But he had kept the bag of tricks hidden under the polished veneer of the old families and the Ivy League. Upon meeting him for the first time, people beheld simply, as Josephus Daniels, his chief at the Navy Department, once put it, as handsome a figure of an attractive young man as I had ever seen. He exhibited all the qualities of a prize show horse. It was sheer pleasure to be in his company. He had every advantage that family, money, good schooling, and good luck could provide, and ever since the mild social hardships of Groton and Harvard, his connections had brought him positions of prestige and power. His mother had gotten him his first job in a Wall Street law firm. The power brokers of his home county in upstate New York had invited him to enter state politics. He had been named to Woodrow Wilson's sub-cabinet at the age of 31 without even asking for the job. He had won the nomination for vice president without raising a finger for it. The odds had always favored him. The polio virus was at hand. It always had been at hand, circulating anywhere human beings lived together. In recent times, it had become more dangerous. But the new danger lay in the humans, not in the virus. When Franklin Roosevelt was growing up in the 1880s, hardly anyone even knew that of all the lame children in the world, a scattered few had been crippled by an infectious microorganism. Their number was inconsequential compared to the throngs of children brought down by far more dangerous microorganisms that caused scarlet fever, yellow fever, typhoid fever, cholera, smallpox, tuberculosis, whooping cough, and diphtheria. The polio virus could kill and maim, but for most of its history, it seldom did so. The reason seems paradoxical. Until the 20th century, the polio virus had caused so little harm because it had been so common in the human community. The polio virus passes from person to person via specks of human waste, and before the coming of modern sanitation in the late 1800s, specks of waste were practically as common as dust. In a 19th century metropolis such as New York, for example, the soaring population overloaded leaky privies, the contents of which often drained into the water supply. The pits beneath the privies were supposed to be cleaned out regularly, their contents hauled away by night soil men and dumped in the rivers. But this makeshift system left plenty of fecal matter in haphazard circulation. The existence of infectious microorganisms, germs, was essentially unknown, so hand washing was not the habitual practice it would become in the 20th century. Only the wealthy had running water inside their homes. Everyone else had to haul whatever water they needed, which meant there was little to be spared for cleaning. In many households, laundry was done infrequently and indifferently, usually with dirty water, and daily bathing was a luxury few could afford. From hand to hand, hand to food, and hand to mouth, specks and smears of feces were heedlessly passed around on every street and in every home. The polio virus rode along. To propagate, it needed to get inside people. Naturally, it found most of its hosts among infants and young children, the sloppiest members of the human tribe. Only a rare child grew up without ingesting the polio virus. It moved from child to child, as the medical historian John R. Paul put it, almost in the same manner that air rushes into a vacuum or water seeks its own level.
But the vast majority escaped serious illness. Their immune systems saved them. A child infected in infancy would likely be protected by antibodies passed through the placenta from his mother. If infected later in childhood, other agents in the immune system were likely to keep him safe. Whenever a tiny intruder enters the human body, a grain of pollen sniffed up the nose, a bacterium or virus that goes down the throat, a sliver poking into the skin, immune cells rush to the scene. First come the cells called phages, from the Greek root to eat. They are blunt weapons that recognize only one distinction among the objects they encounter, the distinction between self and non-self. Anything they find that is non-self, they consume and destroy. But some bits of non-self survive this defense. The next line of cellular defenders, the lymphocytes, are slower to react but more sophisticated. They enjoy a marvelous ability to adapt to specific intruders. Locking with the polio virus, for example, the lymphocyte will clone itself over and over again, creating a legion of new, specialized cells whose sole function is to lock with any new polio virus and destroy it. These cells remain in the human system for good. They guard against any new infection. They immunize the host. So went the quiet career of the polio virus in the era of ubiquitous human waste. A viral particle surviving outside the body in its fecal vessel would invariably wind up in the mouth of nearly every baby. It would multiply in the child's intestine. But the immune system would suppress any severe infection and generate lymphocytes to immunize the child against all future infections. Copies of the virus would be shed in the child's feces and get into other children. But most of them, too, would shed the virus with no harm done. And here another benefit emerged. In the feces of an infected child, there would be intact, or live, copies of the polio virus as well as copies destroyed by the immune system. Yet these killed copies, as they are called, if they entered a human host, would provoke the defensive reaction of lymphocytes just as a healthy virus would. The killed virus could not make a person sick, but it could stimulate a lifelong immunity. The polio virus spread through sewage, but, incredibly, so did immunity to the polio virus. A few developed poliomyelitis, but only a few. Then came the American Civil War, and a tidal wave of death by disease. Far more deaths than were caused by cannonballs and bullets. This prompted calls for a revolution in sanitation. The germ theory of disease was not yet widely accepted. Diseases were generally understood to be the result of accumulated filth and the miasmas, or smelly clouds, that filth produced. So the obvious remedy was cleanliness, both in the management of daily life and in the running of cities and towns. When cleanliness crusades were seen to work against certain diseases, more and more cities and towns took on the expense of installing sewer systems. By the 1880s and 1890s, many American communities had toilets to flush, and as the germ theory of disease became well known, many Americans were keeping themselves cleaner. With this, the situation of the polio virus began to change. In one community after another, as privies and cesspools gave way to flush toilets and underground pipes that whisked feces away to be decontaminated, the polio virus became less common, in both its live and in its killed state. More and more children reached school age without encountering it, so they never developed the lymphocytes that would protect them against it. Gradually, here and there in Europe and North America, and often in the most sanitary communities, clusters of children grew up without the usual cadre of defenses against the polio virus. Sanitation in these places had not extinguished the virus, but merely excluded it. If the virus got loose here, among people lacking the usual immunities, it would be far more dangerous than before. These facts about the polio virus were unknown even to the best doctors practicing during Franklin Roosevelt's boyhood in the 1880s. By 1921, scientists had discovered that poliomyelitis was caused by a contagious virus, but how the virus was transmitted from person to person remained a mystery. Thanks mostly to medical pioneers such as Louis Pasteur and Joseph Lister, doctors now accepted the germ theory of disease.
but in many cases they knew little about how a particular microorganism passed from one person to another. They didn't know, for instance, whether the polio virus was transmitted by droplets from a sneeze or from hand to hand. They didn't know if it was carried by insects or by tainted food or water. They didn't know if a germ could survive on a tabletop, and they didn't know why an epidemic arose in one town but not another. So in 1893, doctors in and around Boston were at a loss to explain 26 cases of paralytic poliomyelitis, several times the number they had seen in any previous year. The following summer, the town of Rutland, Vermont, saw 132 cases, a genuine epidemic in that small town. And most of the victims were not babies, but older children. The disease had become known as infantile paralysis because so many of the victims had indeed been infants. But in Rutland, a number of adults were struck as well. Year after year, more outbreaks occurred, but the numbers remained insignificant compared to the great killers. Then, in the summer of 1916, the disease struck with bewildering force. Some 27,000 Americans were diagnosed. More than 6,000 died. Many more were paralyzed. The epidemic was worst in New York City, where more than 9,000 were paralyzed, including large numbers of babies. Frightened parents rushed their children out of the city. Public health officials imposed quarantines. But none of these measures seemed to do any good. Health officials could give parents only common sense advice about protecting their children, prevent overfatigue, keep them away from large gatherings and from persons with colds, since it was possible the infecting agent was expelled from the nose or throat in coughs and sneezes. Avoid ice cream parlors, soda fountains, and restaurants suspected of uncleanliness. Keep children's fingers out of their noses. Keep them away from dust raised by the sweeping of streets, sidewalks, and homes. Swat flies. How any parent could hope to do all of this was a perplexity. The result was rampant anxiety. In the summers of 1917, 1918, 1919, and 1920, outbreaks were smaller and more isolated. Influenza was a much greater danger in those years, and the fear of infantile paralysis faded. But doctors could no more explain why the infantile had receded than they could explain why it had attacked so brutally in 1916. Now, in 1921, the disease's summer season was beginning again. New York's first cases were reported in the last week of July in upstate Utica. Then several children were struck in Westchester County, just north of New York City. Three cases, all children, were reported in nearby Paterson, New Jersey. The numbers were small. Public health officials saw no need to fear a recurrence of 1916, and even if they had, they would not have known how to prevent it. Epidemiology and history are nowhere near precise enough to trace the exact events that led to Franklin Roosevelt's infection, but one can map the most likely possibilities. One of the stronger possibilities is that somewhere in New York or northern New Jersey, in late June or early July, the polio virus entered a particular boy who was bound for the Boy Scout campsites at Bear Mountain. Down in his small intestine, the virus was snagged by a crooked projection that protruded like a tiny tree branch from the wall of an intestinal cell. Virus and cell interlocked. Then the virus penetrated the cell wall and began to make copies of itself. Over the next few days, the boy may or may not have felt ill. If he did, it was probably no more than a slight stomach ache or headache, and certainly not severe enough to make him tell his mother. He would not have wanted to miss that trip up the Hudson River. That was one possible source of infection, a Boy Scout infected at home. Another possible source was associated with the terrain of Bear Mountain itself. The park sits in the Hudson Highlands, the rumpled ridge that shoulders up to the river between New York City and West Point. The mountain and the lands nearby had become a public preserve by the generosity of Mary Averill Harriman, widow of the banking and railroad magnate E.H. Harriman. As a boy in the 1850s, E.H. Harriman often hiked through the woods of the Highlands. In 1885, he purchased a chunk of the forest southwest of Bear Mountain to protect the land from encroachment by lumber and mining interests, and he built a summer home there. Over the years, he added more tracts to the original to create one of the great natural preserves in the northeastern United States. After Harriman's death in 1909, Mrs. Harriman arranged to give thousands of acres to the state as a woodland retreat for New York's millions, provided the state give up its plans to move the Sing Sing Penitentiary to Bear Mountain and instead make that property a public park as well. So these sprawling tracts of forest became the first of America's great state parks. Two adjoining parks, actually, Bear Mountain State Park along the western shore of the Hudson, and Harriman State Park in the rolling woodlands southwest of the mountain. In the 1910s, construction crews swarmed through the woods, damming streams to make lakes and building pavilions, campgrounds, docks, ice houses, and a network of roads and trails. Then crowds of New Yorkers came, and by 1920 the park's boosters were calling it the greatest playground in the world, with more visitors annually than all the national parks combined. It had been conceived as a place of escape from the city, but in fact, on the busiest days of July and August, the whole city seemed to have come to the park. Catching the Hudson Dayline steamer in Manhattan for a trip to Bear Mountain was a highlight of the season for thousands of New York families. Many visitors were sponsored by settlement houses and philanthropists in the belief that fresh air and rustic pleasures were good medicine for the poor and their children, delinquent children, crippled children, working boys and girls, orphans. Then there were the Boy Scouts, who came in packs of roughly 2,000 at a time, with a staff of 50. Each group staying for 2 weeks at a string of 16 permanent campsites built around three lovely man-made lakes, Upper, Middle, and Lower Kahnawake Lakes. So on any given day of the summer, the population of a fair-sized city was hiking the trails, roaming the woods, eating lunches out of picnic hampers, wading in streams, and swimming in the lakes and ponds. This was the Harriman's dream come true, but the park's popularity came too quickly. Almost no one knew it, but by 1920, the water at Bear Mountain was dangerous. In the fall of that year, at the request of New York's Public Health Council, the State Department of Health sent its water quality expert, Earl Devendorf, a civil engineer, to make an inspection of sanitary conditions throughout the park. After a thorough survey, Devendorf concluded that the human invasion of the Bear Mountain and Harriman forests had outpaced the authorities' ability to keep the park's drinking water clean. At some bathing beaches and campsites, he reported, chemical toilets had been installed, but there were not enough of them, and waste was being disposed of improperly. At many sites, the pit privies were in an insanitary condition. The danger of contamination was not confined to the campsites. Down in the ground, below the highlands, spurts and sheets of molten lava had long ago penetrated the ancient beds of granite. The native granite and lava flow now formed something like a petrified sandwich of many layers, shot through with cracks and fissures. Through these long, wandering cracks, groundwater could move for miles. No one really knew where a bucket of water drawn at the Boy Scout camp had come from. For this reason, Devendorf said, all those springs and wells were to be viewed with suspicion. As the engineer pointed out, with the very large summer population, consisting mainly of young boys and girls and numbering at times over 75,000, which roam promiscuously over the entire park area, any supply derived from a stream, pond, or spring is subject to the accidental, incidental, or chance pollution from such a population. In plainer words, children playing outdoors in the summertime were apt to shit in the woods, and as Devendorf said, the probability of disease carriers being present in such a large population is very great. In fact, Devendorf had discovered that nearly every spring and well in the camping region of the park contained specimens of coliform bacteria. This indicated the presence of unfiltered human waste in the water. So the polio virus was in the water too. It was late afternoon when Pocantio deposited its passengers at the Bear Mountain docks. Buses carried them around the mountain and down Seven Lakes Road through Keen Country, as a brochure described it. It was wild, big, away from everywhere, with inspiring heights. At the camps, under old stands of oak, ash, and hemlock,
Roosevelt and his party found 2,100 boys, 1,200 of them from New York, the rest from New Jersey. Boys and men convened at the mess hall for what the newspapers called a regular old-fashioned Southern chicken dinner. Franklin Roosevelt was chosen as toastmaster. With four sons at home under the age of 14, he had no trouble making a bunch of boys laugh. His yearning to charm an audience, whether a crowd of 1,000 or a single soul he had just met, was inexhaustible. He was always quick to shake hands. Like a seed, the virus had come into being as one of millions, nearly all of which would miss their marks, fall apart, and blow away. Survival of the line depended on just one finding a host cell and beginning anew the process of recreation. If the virus came by water, that is, from one of the tainted wells or ponds somewhere in the park, it was now at the campsite. Perhaps it was suspended in a bucket of water or a pitcher of lemonade. It might have been floating in a basin where the forks were soaked after dinner. Then the forks were gathered quickly and placed on a picnic table next to pieces of pie set out for dessert. Or the virus may have stuck to the finger of the infected boy from New York or New Jersey. Maybe he had run from the privy to the mess tent without washing his hands. Maybe he had picked up an apple from a bowl or a piece of fried chicken from a platter and then, when a friend called him away, put the apple or the piece of chicken back. Perhaps he had run up to greet the famous man. Whether it came by the water or the boy or by some other unknowable route, the virus was now directly at hand. From the tainted cup or the dirty fork, or from the boy's hand to Roosevelt's hand, from the red surface of the apple or the crispy skin of the chicken, from Roosevelt's hand to his tongue, the virus passed into Roosevelt's mouth. He swallowed. Chapter 2. Symptoms, July 29 to August 11, 1921. Pocantico delivered FDR back to Manhattan that night in time for him to sleep at his home at 49 East 65th Street. Only the servants were there. His wife and children were up at the family's summer home on Campobello Island, just off the eastern tip of Maine. In the morning, he went downtown to his office where he had paperwork to clear off his desk. He was assisted by Marguerite A. Lehand, a tall young woman of 23 with an extraordinary combination of intelligence, efficiency, good cheer, and wit. She had worked in the Navy Department, then in the offices of the Cox-Roosevelt campaign, where FDR's wife, Eleanor Roosevelt, noticed her ability and suggested that FDR hire her as his personal secretary. Miss Lehand and FDR finished the work in a few hours. He was set to spend several days at the family's estate at Hyde Park, New York, 2 hours north of New York by train, where a mass of disorganized personal papers from the Navy Department needed his attention. Then he would spend a couple of weeks with family and friends at Campobello. Marguerite Lehand, who was perhaps already half in love with her new boss, watched him leave the office. Years later, when she was far into her tenure in Roosevelt's closest circle, she was asked what made a good secretary, and she replied, "The first thing for a private secretary to do is to study her employer." She had studied her employer well already. And a few days later, she wrote Mrs. Roosevelt, "I thought he looked quite tired when he left." If the polio virus entered Roosevelt's body at Bear Mountain, it probably infected others there, too. Yet there is no evidence of an outbreak among the Boy Scouts. Reported cases of polio in New York State mounted for several weeks. But the numbers were highest more than 200 miles away in and around upstate Utica, not in the region of New York City, where most of the scouts lived. If any others were infected that night at Bear Mountain, it appears that all or nearly all fought off the virus and remained healthy. Maybe the terrible events that overtook Roosevelt in the following days and weeks were the result of sheer bad luck, a one-in-a-million chance. Maybe the virus eluded every agent of his immune system purely by accident. But it is hard to avoid the suspicion that he was especially vulnerable. If so, why? Several factors might have played a part, acting alone or in concert. The first factor was the condition Marguerite Lehand noticed on July 29th.
Roosevelt was indeed tired. He had been driving himself without a pause for many months. And a few days earlier, in the middle of July, he had undergone an ordeal that shook his confidence and taxed his remaining stamina. He had arisen from an old scandal at the Naval Training Station at Newport, Rhode Island. 2 years earlier, in 1919, newspapers had printed allegations of homosexual liaisons among sailors and civilians there. Roosevelt was then the Navy's assistant secretary, or second in command, in charge of the enormous department's day-to-day affairs. He had authorized an investigation at Newport, though whether he had authorized the particular surveillance methods, which included the use of young sailors to entrap others into sexual encounters, was a matter of dispute. Without evidence, the Providence Journal accused Roosevelt of personally directing the whole operation, thus imperiling the morals of the sailors used as bait, some of them teenagers. Roosevelt denied it. He said he had done no more than order officers to clean up vice at the station. The moment he learned about the admittedly outrageous methods, he said, he had ordered them stopped. The hubbub faded, then flared again during the 1920 campaign as Republicans looked for ways to embarrass the Cox-Roosevelt ticket. After the Democrats were defeated, Republicans in the U.S. Senate continued to gather evidence. Then, in mid-July 1921, Josephus Daniels, Roosevelt's old chief at the Navy Department and a leading Democrat, heard that senators were about to release findings libelous to both himself and FDR. He urged Roosevelt to mount a defense in person. FDR rushed to Washington. When he reached the Capitol, his accusers gave him a single day to read and prepare a response to some 6,000 pages of testimony. In the poisonous Potomac heat, he paged through the volumes to find renewed charges that he must have known about and likely approved most deplorable, disgraceful, and unnatural acts. He scribbled a forceful denial and issued it to reporters that evening, but it was too late. The Republican majority had released its report to the press without waiting for his response. The coverage was embarrassing, including a front-page headline in the next morning's New York Times. But it was not as heavy as FDR and Daniels had feared, and, much to their relief, there had been no follow-up in the 2 weeks since. Still, FDR was unnerved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.